Hello, Simon Dixon here, CEO and co-founder of BnkToTheFuture.com, and I'm here today with Daniel Vogel from Bitso, and he's the co-founder and president of Bitso. Say hello, Daniel.
Hi, how's everyone? Hi, Simon. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure. Okay, so we're here for a general investor update on what's been happening with Bitcoin in Mexico and particularly Bitso. And also it might make for some interesting content for those who are following this space as well. So Daniel, do you want to just give us a quick update? So around the world, we've been seeing Bitcoin, I believe, become more and more of a store of value. And we're seeing some, you know, we're trying to overcome some scaling issues, which are making Bitcoin more of an expensive transaction vehicle or currency than we've seen in the past. However, the user case of store of value seems to be a global phenomenon. So our investments in you know, Bitcoin companies, they're all seeing, you know, really big increases in the number of people interested in Bitcoin, storing Bitcoin and perhaps trading Bitcoin. What are we actually seeing on the ground there in Mexico with Bitcoin?
Yeah, so we're seeing a significant increase in users as well. We've doubled basically our user base in the last 3 months. We went from just shy of 25,000 users to over 60,000 users now. We've seen our volumes, our exchange volumes, continue to go up significantly. We went from, in March of 2017, so just this past month, we basically processed more volume than we had in all of 2016 combined. So that was very exciting for us. We are, however, being affected by these high transaction fees in the Bitcoin network. Even though we do see a significant number of users who rely on Bitcoin as a store of value, for those of you who don't know, Mexico has been going on through some rocky times with the recent US presidential election. Our exchange rate with the dollar was very negatively affected in November 8th, the day of the US elections, and as President Trump assumed presidency, our exchange rate with the dollar kept basically depreciating, and we had a significant number of users who started to rely on Bitcoin to store and protect themselves against these devaluation. However, we have a significant number of users that rely on Bitcoin to transact. And as these fees have increased, it's become more expensive to subsidize those fees for users. And so unfortunately, we're going to be moving away from subsidizing minor fees for all of our users to actually requiring a small fee for withdrawing coins from Bitso. Which is unfortunately because we had seen a significant number of users rely on this technology to do things like payments, people who were using it specifically for cross-border payments, and we are also an Ether exchange, so we also have Ether on the platform, and so we have seen some users migrating their cross-border transactions to Ether because of the sort of lower transaction fees that exist there.
Interesting. So I think this is in line with what's happening across the board, really. You know, some of the predominant companies in America, like BitPay and Coinbase, have all decided that it's now time to pass on transaction fees, because before they were happy to subsidize them. But now Bitcoin has got record volume and it's more popular. Those transaction fees are increasing as we figure out how to get through this scaling debate. At Bitso, you have two main currency pairs, or is there more? Is it Bitcoin to Mexican Peso and Ethereum to Mexican Peso? What other markets do you deal with?
That's correct. Those are the only markets that we currently have. We do have some surprises in line that should be coming up in the next month or so. So stay tuned for those, but we'll make some big announcements.
Okay. So, but your Ethereum market is it from Bitcoin to Ethereum, or is it directly Mexican pesos to Ethereum?
It's Mexican pesos to Ether. Yep.
Okay. So, what seems to be happening then is that more and more exchanges are now taking some of these things that were considered altcoins, where Bitcoin was the on-ramps to get into the altcoins. But I think now we're seeing exchanges where there's enough volume now to directly trade fiat to Ethereum, which is creating this interesting scenario, I guess, where people seem to be using Bitcoin as a store of value, but you're saying you're noticing that people are trading their Bitcoin to Ethereum in order to take advantage of speed and lower transaction fees, but they're still using Bitcoin as a store of value. Would you say, how would you summarize it if you think how people are using it on your exchange?
Right. So we obviously still see a significant number of people who rely on Bitcoin as a store of value and who are interested in the technology as a store of value. And I think Bitcoin has positioned itself as probably the safest platform and the safest technology to store value. However, we see these competing currencies, Ethereum being a really interesting one, that are building more liquidity around the world and liquidity against fiat pairs, like you're just mentioning. And these other currencies provide with a different set of benefits over Bitcoin, if you want to call them that. So if you take, for example, the case of Ethereum, when you send a transaction between Bitso and another Ethereum supporting exchange somewhere else in the world, usually you require 30 confirmations, so 30 blocks. But Ethereum blocks are produced at a much higher rate than Bitcoin ones. And so what that means is that in order to get 30 confirmations on the blockchain, on the Ethereum blockchain, that takes about 6 minutes compared to, for example, 4 to 6 confirmations that are usually needed on the Bitcoin network, which translate to 40 to 60 minutes. And so let's say that you are a user in Mexico and you're trying to send some money to Europe, or it's the inverse, you're someone who's receiving a remittance in Mexico, and now you seem to have these sort of different technologies that you could use. One of them is Bitcoin, one of them is Ethereum. And if you are agnostic to the fact that, you know, maybe there is a lot more hashing power on the Bitcoin network and it's more secure, but average users, I don't think, fully understand that yet. And so for them, the difference is, okay, well, I can send these things with Bitcoin. And when I do it with Bitcoin, I need to pay a transaction fee. And that transaction fee can be now, you know, 50 cents to a dollar. And it's going to take me 40 to 60 minutes to receive it on the other end. Or I can use it with this other thing called Ethereum, which seems to not charge me as high of a fee, maybe 50 cents. And I can get it over to the other exchange in 5 to 6 minutes. And what I'm going to do on the other side is I'm just going to immediately sell it. You see why, you know, why some people would start preferring these other technologies like Ethereum to achieve some things, which is interesting because Ethereum was originally not built to be like a cross-border, you know, payment currency. It's more to be, a machine to execute code that is immutable and that can run on censored on thousands of computers around the world. And so but it still has this functionality of being a currency and acting like a currency and that it can be used for cross-border transactions. So we are seeing people who are migrating some of these activities over to Ethereum. Now the problem with Ethereum is that you know, you don't have as widespread of a use. So you don't have as many exchanges around the world that support it. You don't have as much liquidity around the world as Bitcoin does. You don't have many merchants who accept payments in Ether. Whereas you do have a ton of merchants who accept payments in Bitcoin. You have basically a Bitcoin exchange in almost, you know, every fiat pair that's out there in the world. I mean, there's some places that are still in the dark, but mostly you can get Bitcoin converted into fiat anywhere in the world now. And so so obviously these things are competing with each other. We are very curious as to what's going to happen with this blockchain debate, block size debate, and whether we're going to be able to reach a solution anytime soon, because we do feel like Bitcoin is losing some of its edge against these other currencies. And some people argue that maybe Bitcoin should be just used as a store of value and that should be the utility of Bitcoin. And maybe that's fair, but I think, you know, these currencies become a lot more useful when you can use them for many things. And we're very hopeful that Bitcoin is going to be able to solve this. But at the same time, it's important for us to start really looking hard at these alternatives, and especially because we're not pushing these use cases on users, right? It's users themselves figuring out that there's these competing currencies that have other properties that may be more relevant or better for my specific use case. No?
So, do you do a Bitcoin to Ether trading pair?
We don't have a Bitcoin to Ether trading pair yet, but so we only have two order books on the exchange: Mexican pesos to Bitcoin and Mexican pesos to Ether.
Okay, awesome. It's a really interesting crossroads that exchanges are having to go through right now, because you know, many of the exchanges built their user experience to be as friendly as possible, and yet we're now reaching these interesting scenarios where, you know, there's the possibility that Bitcoin might go through a hard fork, and therefore I noticed that your name was down on the public announcement stating that if there was a hard fork, you'd need protection from replay, and also that you would treat it as a different pair and there'd be a new pair. So, you know, I really, to me, it's very important to avoid this hard fork at all costs, because I just don't want everyone to have to explain to everyone there's two versions of Bitcoin. And now you're in this scenario where, okay, we've got to accept Ether because that's creating a new market, which I guess is good for an exchange because it's new volume, it's new interest. But now I guess you're at this situation where, well, what about Zcash? What about Dash? What about all these other things that are coming through? And how do you draw the line between, you know, what is a passing fad or what's got, lost ability? And now you've got to adjust all your user experience. I guess, you know, there's a good and a bad. The good is that there's new volume, there's new opportunities, which I guess can only grow the exchange. But at the same time, you've got to figure out how to make these work. Are you still seeing that have you got a thought on what your roadmap ahead there, or is this just a constant area of debate and tension within the company?
This is a significant area of debate and tension within the company, because I think, you know, when we set out to build Bitso, we were very intrigued at the possibility of basically building a completely separate but cheaper, faster, and more accessible digital global financial system, and that this possibility would come true with the use of digital currencies. When you start seeing the roadmap of Bitcoin being just so stuck because inability from the community and the industry to come together and push forward in one or the other direction, and having this, you know, very contentious time where nobody knows, as you say, if this is going to split or if it's not going to split, and how do you explain that to users, and how do you deal with that operationally? We dealt with the Ethereum hard fork last year, because we've had Ethereum for over a year now. And when Ether and Ether Classic came to be, it was a real, you know, challenge for us to basically build a number of things. But Ether has this interesting capability of smart contracts, and we're able to build a smart contract to basically build replay protection into our operations from the get-go. But Bitcoin doesn't really have that, and so there's some people who have talked about how would you do it, but there doesn't seem to be like one very safe way or easy way to do it and manage it. So we really hope that it doesn't get to that. But then we get into this sort of interesting debate, which is, you know, should we be the ones who decide which are the relevant assets? And should we say, you know, we're interested in X, Y, and Z, and the best poised digital currencies to achieve these are, you know, Bitcoin and Ether and whatever else? Or do we want to give people the choice and build liquidity for all these different pairs? And so it's interesting because we never set out to be one of these multi-currency exchanges that just allow you to trade with anything. And our main purpose is for people to speculate on these assets. It was to build use cases on top of these assets. But what we've seen is, you know, with this recent use case of Ethereum is well, okay, Ether wasn't very useful for anything a year ago, and we added it because we thought the technology was very interesting. And now when you start seeing that, you know, our volume in Ether is growing 8x compared to, you know, doubling of Bitcoin volume in the last month, and you start seeing like, wow, Ether is really growing, and what are people using Ether for? And you start digging into it, and you start seeing like, wow, all these things that I thought people would always use Bitcoin for, now people are using Ether for it. Simply because maybe the blocks aren't full and transactions can still be cheap. And maybe Ether will run into the same problem of at some point getting really congested and requiring really high fees. But it's not there yet, and it serves a function today. And so it's very difficult to learn where to draw the line, because you start seeing these very interesting improvements on these other digital currencies that are doing things that Bitcoin can't really experiment with very easily because of the fact that it has such an amount of value that it's storing. And so when you do things like Zcash, which you know improve privacy significantly, you know, obviously, I think everyone would love to see something like that to migrate over to Bitcoin, but it's unclear how you would ever get that in Bitcoin, no? And it's difficult for us to figure out whether we should be the ones deciding and saying, no, we're only going to have these three digital currencies, or if our role as an exchange is to simply build the markets and provide liquidity and allow our users to decide and the market to decide what is relevant and what is not. But obviously that comes, every single digital currency comes with the added operational expense of keeping the assets safely, of building processes for managing these assets. And it's not clear that it's the best use of resources for a small team to basically just build an exchange with hundreds of trading pairs, you know, where people are going to be just mainly speculating on their value.
Yeah. So are you mainly taking the approach that, you know, if something looks like it's going to be significant, then you'll look to spend the time and the operational resource to do it, but you're kind of leaving the, you know, other exchanges and the market to determine what can build up the liquidity, you know, from the exchanges that can move very fast because they don't deal with fiat like you do, and right. Maybe allow them to prove the market rather than trying to speculate, because it's really easy to get caught up in the hype of what something can be, but a year later it can become quite apparent what it is going to be.
Yeah, sure. And I think what we're gonna do is we're gonna experiment a little bit more, and we're gonna see if we add maybe a new pair and see what the market does with that. And if we find significant indications that there are legitimate use cases for some of these other digital currencies, then we may adjust our stance. But at the moment, I think we're sticking with Bitcoin, Ether, thinking of adding a third pair, not entirely sure, a third currency, not entirely sure we're gonna do that. But we've learned a lot from Ether, and I think there's probably a lot more to be learned by adding something else.
So it seems to me that the, you know, the reason that you got into the Bitcoin exchange in the first place is because you saw the potential of a non-speculative user case, whether that be remittances or whatever it is, and you seem right. to have done followed the same path with Ethereum, where you're not sure exactly what it is, but you saw this non-speculative user case of smart contracts, and now you started to see that there's some of these smart contracts. It seems like ICOs is the main user case at the moment, but we're also seeing value routing from those that are storing their value in Bitcoin and want a very quick and cheaper mechanism to quickly trade out of Bitcoin into Ethereum, into that pair, and then maybe hold it back in Bitcoin on the other side. But I think the important thing to say is that while people watching this, it may be easy to start thinking, is Bitcoin going through a really challenging time at the moment? It's important to put in context that we're now at record volume. We have lots of interesting solutions. And I personally favor the belief that Bitcoin is an incredible store of value and that's not going anywhere. So let's make sure that we don't break that. Bitcoin is an incredible store of value. That property is not broken by, you know, whether transaction volume is cheap or whether we can process transactions fast. And therefore, you know, is important not to break that. And if it means that another pair is going to become a faster, cheaper currency, then that still doesn't break the value that Bitcoin brings to the market. Okay, we just had some interference, so we had to change microphones, but I think we're all back on again now, and we'll just edit this together. We were discussing Bitcoin as a store of value and how that user case is, you know, not really at risk at the moment. It's in, you know, you can get caught up in the negativity, but still, you know, Bitcoin is very strong as that store of value. It's just a question of whether it's going to be strong in all the other things that we've been used to in the past, I guess.
Yeah, no, absolutely. A lot of people want Bitcoin to be everything. We want Bitcoin to be a store of value, a medium of exchange, a unit of account. And it's unclear at the moment where it can be all those things, at least immediately and safely. And even one of those, any one of those three things is still hugely amazing, you know, that a digital currency can achieve that. I think one of the most interesting things about technology is that technology continues to advance and it continues to surprise us. And if this would be 1995 and you were thinking of, you know, the fact that people would be streaming whole movies, 15 years afterwards on their mobile phones as they're walking around the subway, people would think that you were absolutely crazy. And that's what's happening today. You know, like I walk around and sometimes when I'm walking around, I'm watching YouTube videos on interviews that are happening sometimes on real time, you know, somewhere else in the world. And so, I wouldn't say that the fact that Bitcoin is going through some tough scaling times is necessarily a game stopper for digital currencies. I think it's the natural evolution of technology. And I'm sure that 10 years down the road, we're all going to look back and we're going to say, oh, remember those crazy block size debates and how everyone thought that Bitcoin was going to go, you know, was going to burn, and we're going to laugh about it. And I think, you know, I'm 31 years old. I hope to have kids at some point. I think my kids are going to laugh when I tell them that I used to have these paper and metal things that I used to carry around to exchange with people. No, but these things take time. And so, I think the people behind Bitcoin are incredibly smart individuals, very excited about what they're doing, and I hope that we can figure out as a community how to move forward. And we're seeing some interesting developments in some of these other currencies. Some things like SegWit are getting activated in other currencies. I think it's activated on Syscoin. We understand that it might be close to activating on Litecoin. And we'll see, maybe we can find, we're hopeful that we'll be able to find some compromises and we hope that we can do so soon and continue scaling Bitcoin so that many of its use cases can still be realized, even if now the answer is that it's a store of value and it's great at that. And I don't think anyone can debate that it's a great store of value, but I think we, at least I am, and I believe everyone in Bitso is still very hopeful that Bitcoin can be great at all these other things as well. And if we have to wait a little bit for that, then we'll have to wait a little bit for that. But
yeah, and what I do say to others as well is be careful what you ask for, because Bitcoin is a great currency. A great currency normally implies stable prices. It's why US dollar is, you know, one of the best currencies and accepted in many places. But US dollar in many cases is like the best of a bad bunch at store of value, because US dollar seems to be the most widely accepted currency and others fluctuate a lot. But a great currency, if Bitcoin were to be a great currency, would mean that we'd have a flat price. A store of value is something where the principles are, you know, make the price and your purchasing power go up over time. more than inflation. Yeah. And Bitcoin has been the highest performing currency for six of the last 7 years in terms of as a store of value. So you got to be careful what you ask for. Now, I love having a store of value which has a payment system attached to it, which allows me to send, you know, I still, when we send high value transactions, they're still done extremely cheaply, in my opinion, and we're happy to do that. It's just whether that micro transaction user case and the ability for an exchange to swallow all the mining fees, these things kind of diminish, which I think leads nicely into, let's get back to Mexico. Because when you started this, you mentioned that the market interpreted Donald Trump becoming the president of the United States as a bad thing for Mexico. And that's led to some devaluation of the Mexican peso relative to the US dollars. Could you explain a bit about what, you know, how the market perceived that, why, what Donald Trump actually means for Mexico, and why you think that led to you doubling the number of people that are looking to purchase Bitcoin through your exchange?
Sure. So if you think of the day of the US presidential elections in November, you know, it was 6 p.m. in Mexico City time, and the expectation was that Hillary Clinton would become the president of the next president of the United States. The Mexican peso to US dollar exchange rate was at about $18.50 to a dollar. And suddenly, right around that time, things started changing. And what we started seeing was states that everyone thought would turn Democrat started going Republican. And literally, as that happened, the peso started devaluing. And the reason for that is because in the presidential campaign, President Trump talked significantly about, you know, things that would negatively impact Mexico's economy, specifically things like renegotiating the free trade agreement, the NAFTA, the North America Free Trade Agreement. And, you know, our biggest trade partner is the United States. And if that trade agreement were to cease to exist, you know, Mexico's economy would struggle, because we'd lose a significant partnership with our biggest trade partner. And so, you know, I think markets have to react to that, and they have to react to the possibility that something like that were to happen. And you know, what's going to happen if he does become president of the United States? And literally, as you know, at that time the banks were closed in Mexico, and if you had some pesos, it was practically impossible to do anything with those pesos at 6 p.m. the day of the elections, unless you were a Bitso customer. And so the phone started ringing and people started calling and, hey, you know, how do I turn some pesos into Bitcoin? Like, yeah. And what we saw was the exchange rate went from 1860 at about 6 p.m. to about 21 pesos to a dollar the next day, about 26 hours later. And so what that meant for you as a Mexican was that if you were holding pesos, suddenly you had lost a significant portion of your acquisition power if you were talking in US terms, no? Unless you were holding Bitcoin in Mexico. And people who did that did phenomenally well, did really, really well. And we saw people who that was their entry point to Bitcoin, right? Like people who had no alternative but to move to an asset that was easy to acquire and that it behaved very differently than the stock market or bonds or, you know, whatever is in your portfolio. Basically, the day of the election, the Mexican peso, the day of the U.S. election, the Mexican peso significantly devalued against the dollar, and there was a lot of. I think there was a lot of uncertainty in the markets as to whether the presidential campaign of Donald Trump was actually going to, you know, the rhetoric that he used during his presidential campaign, whether that was actually going to be something that he was going to be moving forward with, or if it was just, you know, a campaign technique or tactic to get elected as president. At the beginning of January, on January 4th, we saw a big event, which was that Ford had been planning this enormous expansion into Mexico to build this new plant in a place called San Luis Potosí. And they basically canceled their plans and said that they were going to do those in the US instead because they were afraid of tariffs that could be imposed on their plant if they were to build something in Mexico. And so then suddenly the peso saw a huge other devaluation because people understood that the threat of things like the NAFTA agreement being renegotiated were a real possibility. And so, these events are very important to people because they need a way to basically protect themselves against these sort of movements. You know, if you are someone in Mexico, you have absolutely no say do on what the US president's actions are going to be, but you are deeply affected by them. And Bitcoin provides a little bit of a hedge against those things, or maybe not a little bit, maybe a phenomenal hedge against these things. And so we've seen a lot of people who've gotten more and more interested. Now, luckily, the Mexican peso has regained strength, I think, in the last 2 weeks. Specifically, I think, because it's become less clear that that the checks and balances system of the United States can be overridden by a single man. I think the checks and balance systems in the United States has done a pretty good job at making sure that these new policies that want to be introduced by the new president of the United States are not done in a completely unlawful manner, but that they need to go through some due diligence process and they actually need to follow the law. So we've seen a lot of these, for example, the travel ban that was introduced in January was deemed illegal by several judges around the United States. And so as we've seen that, we've seen the peso has continued to regain strength against the dollar, even though it became really, really bad, mid-January. But nonetheless, I think Mexicans are still very, very interested in Bitcoin as a store of value, as a way to protect yourselves against these outside events where you might suddenly significantly lose a large portion of your value, if you're holding everything in Mexican pesos, for example.
Yeah, and I experienced this last year when I live in Hong Kong, but I had savings in pounds during Brexit. I didn't really have any say or control over Brexit, but half the people of Britain decided that it was right to Brexit, which I think will be with all the consequences are coming through now, but I think that would be a good decision when the euro starts to go through its challenges that it's got ahead. but immediately we lost 25% of the value of my savings if I wanted to convert them into Hong Kong dollars or invest them abroad or do something else with them. So, they're stuck in the UK. But fortunately, Bitcoin, countered it by an order of magnitude as well. So that user case of an independent censorship resistance hedge against certain political events that you may not be able to control has become just such an important thing in the world, and why we all are here continuing to make sure that Bitcoin becomes not only what it has become, but it still continues to be, despite the fact that there's lots and lots of policies around the world that are affecting Bitcoin. So this leads to, I think, the final topic that we should be discussing. And that is that, we've seen in China that the central bank has implemented tougher regimes on the exchanges, which I think is a good thing. Because there was fake volume as a result of free trading. There was no ability to prove reserves, and many exchanges in China, I think, are going to be going through a better come out better at the end of it. But the fact of the matter is that there's been suspension of withdrawals, which doesn't help, you know, people that are new to Bitcoin in China that are experiencing that as their first experience, that they can't withdraw their funds. And that's because of the regulators at the moment. In Japan, we've seen the opposite approach, where the regulators have come in and said, right, we recognize Bitcoin as an asset class, and we're going to regulate the exchanges. And that has led to a real boost in the number of merchants that are willing to accept Bitcoin in Japan as a payment method. But also traditional FX brokers and traditional markets integrating with Bitcoin exchanges, which I know was, you know, one of your real goals at Bitso, was to create a safe exchange where traditional finance could also integrate. And so I guess what we're seeing in the world right now is two markets, and I think both of them are booming, which is the regulated market of people that want to intersect between fiat and you know, digital currencies via a regulated exchange where there's more trust in that exchange as a result of regulations, versus the unregulated market, which is still serving a certain user case for those that want privacy, that want to deal peer-to-peer, and you know, there's peer-to-peer exchanges which are also serving that market, and the two are doing incredibly well. What's happening on the regulatory side in Mexico? You know, and also there's this other thing that's always been a challenge in Bitcoin space, which Bitfinex are realizing right now, is that one of their banks has, you know, stopped US dollar transactions. It's not even the bank they deal with, because they deal with a Taiwanese bank, but it's the correspondent bank that deals with the clearing to US dollars. They're stopping the Taiwanese bank from processing those, so they have to find other solutions. So I guess if you could update us on those final two things, you know, what's happening with banking and government policy in Mexico, and is Mexico going to be, you know, one of the next user cases where we see the impact of regulations or banking trying to halt the market?
Yeah, so we believe that digital currencies have tremendous amount of use cases for regulated financial institutions like banks. And we believe that the amount of trust that individuals place on exchanges, and unfortunately we've seen this happen in the Bitcoin world before, where exchanges, you know, lose customer funds, or sometimes don't keep full reserves of customer funds, et cetera, et cetera, have done really bad by customers. And so we are of the opinion that when you have an entity that requires a high amount of trust from customers, that it should probably become a regulated entity. I think we've seen very interesting use cases of companies or products around the crypto space that don't require this amount of trust. You know, companies that, for example, don't hold customer funds, and where companies that don't have the unilateral ability to execute or prevent funds from moving. And I think those are very, very interesting use cases, and I don't believe those use cases should be regulated. But when you have someone
like Shapeshift, for example.
Exactly, Shapeshift is a great example of that, right? Like they don't keep customer funds, and as such, I don't think there's really a big requirement for them to get regulated. However, when I think of Bitso, and I think of, you know, people are sending their hard-earned fiat money, and I am promising them that when they buy Bitcoins through us, that we actually have those Bitcoins for them. You know, customers are placing a high amount of trust. And we believe we are an incredibly ethical company, and have all sorts of procedures internally to make sure that, you know, we are fully that customer funds are always fully liquid and always in our 100% reserves of customer funds. But we always wonder, you know, what would happen if another company would come in and open shop here in Mexico and do something evil. And we actually had a competitor in Mexico a while ago, and they one day closed shop. And I am not sure exactly what happened to them, and I can't say that what happened was evil or wrong, but it was still scary. It was still scary because the authorities look at this and they're probably not very pleased, right? Like, oh, what happened to all these people who had money in this exchange? And so, and at the same time, what we've seen is that there's been significant movement worldwide on regulation of this activity. You know? So we've seen, as you mentioned, in Japan, but we've seen things like a Bit license, and more states in the United States are looking at, you know, Bitcoin specific license, and you start to see things, a lot of rulings in Europe and a lot of and rulings in places like the Philippines. And so we believe that, you know, financial institutions have traditionally been very regulated. It's a very regulated space, and for a number of reasons, one of them being this high amount of trust that consumers need to place on your entity. But so we believe that we believe that a business like ours should be regulated in a jurisdiction like Mexico. But you know, the authorities in Mexico have been working on what it would take to regulate Bitcoin in the country and or digital currencies in the country. And we've been central in dealing with the authorities and answering their questions and being completely open with them about what we do and how we're doing in our processes and who we are and what the use cases are and what the opportunity for Mexico is. And I think we've done a good job at making the authorities understand that there's a huge opportunity for them here. You know, there's a huge opportunity to increase things like financial inclusion in the country, to increase access, to lower costs, to offer alternatives, to increase competition in the financial sector space. And I think these are all things that, if you are the authority, you can't really deny that these are good things for a country. And so it's unclear exactly when and if there's going to be a new law, but we can definitely tell you that there's movement and more people in government. So these are people in the central bank, in the Ministry of Finance, in the Banking and Securities Commission, that are reaching out to us and asking for more and more questions and are curious about how it works and what the opportunities and what the challenges and what the risks are. But I'd say that the approach from the authorities has been very, very friendly, very inquisitive, but very, very friendly. And it wouldn't surprise me if Mexico is the next, you know, big case of a federal entity that regulates businesses like ours. No? And what we're trying to do is we're trying to make sure that there's good distinction between business models that require regulation and business models that don't require regulation. Again, going back to the shapeshift example. Right. Or even simpler examples like non-custodial wallets. Like, we want everyone in Mexico to be able to have access to non-custodial wallets that are provided by software providers, as opposed to requiring all of these providers to, you know, get a license in Mexico, which would basically mean they would simply not operate here. And so we sense a good amount of goodwill from the authorities and are excited about the progress, and we'll keep you guys posted as we know more.
Okay. And the other alternative approach is what we've seen in India, and that is that if the government wants to subsidize the growth of Bitcoin, then all they need to do is continue their war on cash. And yeah. So if we saw a similar war in cash in Mexico, I'm sure we'd be having another hangout like this where you're talking about quadruple growth in Absolutely. User bases. And so we're getting, and this is why this is such an exciting space at the moment, because we're just getting these amazing examples all around the world of what happens when you regulate Bitcoin exchanges, what happens if you take another approach of suspending withdrawals, and what happens if you eliminate cash from economy. And there's been no other time in history that we've actually been able to see simultaneously all these user cases. And then what happens if you have a currency that has no borders and doesn't care? And today is the only time that we can actually see that. So it's very exciting. Thanks for the update, Daniel. I remember just before we started this, you were saying that you've got three exciting things coming up that you might not be able to discuss because you don't like to announce things until they're actually there. Is there any hints you can give us at what lies ahead and what we've got to be excited about, or do we have to save it for another update once you can say?
We'll have to save it for another update, but if any of the people watching are going to be at Consensus, we're hoping to make an announcement there. So stay tuned.
Okay, so what's that, May 24th or something in New York? Okay.
That's exactly right.
All right. Okay. Thanks, Daniel. It's really interesting to see what's happening. Congratulations on the growth you're experiencing. And do keep us in the loop of where Bitcoin's going to go in Mexico. And we look forward to the next one. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Thank you, Simon. And thanks to all the people watching, too.